Ruta Nacional 40 by Magnus Stanke, read by Alberto Ruano. Anybody awake? Drew's question tore me out of my reverie and I opened my eyes. The dark, featureless landscape we were driving through made it hard to gauge how fast we were going. Could have been 30 or 70. It's hard in daytime and pretty much impossible at night. It certainly felt fast, excessively so, perhaps. Anyways, I'd dozed off or had been hallucinating. Extreme altitude will do that to you. And I was grateful to be torn out of my dreams. It's no fun being mauled by indigenous zombies, even if they're imaginary. Instinctively, I looked at the screensaver of my mobile. No signal, of course. Only my screensaver. A stunning picture of a lake surrounded by snow-covered mountains from down in Patagonia, where we'd set out a couple of weeks ago. Yeah, I'm up, I said. And why did you turn the radio off? I never fall asleep when the radio's playing.
I didn't. It just kinda zoned out a while back, Drew replied.
Poor Drew. Driving on Ruta Nacional 40, that's Route 40 for you and me, Argentina's longest highway, which runs from the southern tip of the country all the way to its border with Bolivia, some 5,200 kilometers farther north. It's no picnic, especially at night when your two road trip companions are off in slumberland, rocked to sleep by potholes so deep even the fabulous suspension of the South Korean three-row SUV can't deny. For long, long stretches, there are virtually no landmarks on either side of the road, and of course, there are no streetlights this high up in the Andes, or rather in the Precordillera, where the few godforsaken dusty towns that do exist are set back from the road so far you don't have to worry about slowing down whilst passing through them. If not for speed bumps and rain ditches, you could set your cruise control and keep going all night. What little traffic there is.
Fuck! That was Drew yelling. There was a dull bang, not mega loud, but loud enough to wake me up for good. For an instant, I glimpsed a strange face. Wait, what? What just happened, Drew? You hit something?
I must have spoken louder than intended. Tony stirred on the back row and said, without opening his eyes,
"We hit the compensation jackpot? Is that the pung of money?"
He was right. A peculiar smell had spread in the car, although until he mentioned it, I hadn't noticed anything. With my next intake of breath, an unpleasant, musky stench flooded my nostrils, the kind wild animals emit to mark the boundaries of their territory.
"That thing, it came out of nowhere. It's not my fault," Drew sounded defiant.
"What was it?" I said. Drew whispered, "Fuck do I know." Tony was coming into his own.
No jackpot, huh? Jay, what time is it?
I glanced at my watch. Just gone midnight. I must have slept something like 2 hours. 2 hours and the road was still climbing. How was that possible? I'd studied the maps before we set out today. We should have left the lofty bits of Route 40 hours ago. Did Drew take a wrong turn somewhere? He must have. Well, with me asleep, I couldn't blame him, and I didn't. Even now I don't.
Is this one of your infamous shortcuts?
Tony's voice sounded far away. He laid spread out all over the back row. His face turned towards the rear windshield behind him.
"Che, look, the night's so clear. The stars amazing, but there, on the road behind us, stop, we hit someone."
My blood froze. Tony had said someone, not something. How he managed to make out any details by the light of the stars, I still don't understand. Drew prolonged my raging agony by not answering Tony's question right away. While the unrequited words lingered in the air, my mind conjured up all kinds of movie-induced nightmare images. Poor, creepy kids, Japanese girls with long black hair, avenging Indians, victims of vicious bullying on a rampage of vengeance against some hapless, carefree alpha kids like us, wealthy white millennials whose only guilt is having been born into prosperity. At last, Drew's voice burst through my unhealthy stream of thought. "Some kind of animal, a rabbit or something, I think." Tony was still looking out.
"Yeah? Well, whatever it is, it's still moving. It's not that, you would-be roadkill. Stop already!"
Before I could say, "What do you want to stop for? Some mouth-to-mouth?" Drew hit the brakes. The SUV went into a tailspin, which wasn't the way it was supposed to react on a pebble road. When it finally did stop, we'd gone a little off the track, and I felt Drew's accusing eyes on me as though this was somehow my fault.
"What?"
"It came out of nowhere, bro. The road, this fucking dirt track, was all clear. Empty. You saw yourself. Then suddenly those eyes, boom!" Drew demonstrated the impact by slapping his hands together.
In the hope of getting the smell out of my airways, I climbed out of the car and filled my lungs with night air. Up here, breathing's a drag. There's so little oxygen around that even the smallest physical activity can leave you breathless. Since crossing the 3,000-meter line, I'd be feeling a severe pressure on my head, my lungs, and my mind. To ease the symptoms of altitude sickness, take the edge off the peaks, so to speak, we'd been chewing coca leaves like cows chew the cud. It's okay. Coca doesn't buzz you like its more famous powdery white relative, and anyway, we'd run out of leaves hours ago. Anyway, I made sure to raise my head slowly. Tony had been right. The night sky was awesome. I'd never seen the Milky Way lit up so brightly, so brilliantly. Drew joined me, and together we stared at the spectacle above us. Awesome or not, the sky didn't offer up any solutions. There was no roadmap to the nearest vet, and we were hardly likely to mercy kill the miserable creature, most likely a fox, a ferret, or a Patagonian Mara, with our bare hands. As Tony crawled out the car, the spell began to dissipate. I think it's dead. It stopped moving. Come on. Without uttering another word, he started towards the small bundle in the road behind us. Was it really dead? It bothered me. All of it. I didn't like the way Jude braked. I didn't like the way we'd stopped, and I didn't like the way our headlights now shone into the nothingness in front of the car. Something was decidedly, unfathomably wrong. You coming, Kev? Jude said. Catch you right up, I answered. I didn't want to stay at the car alone. I wanted to go with them, but my legs didn't obey me, as though they knew better. So I watched my friends shuffle off down the road without me. 200 yards doesn't sound like much, but like I said, at this altitude, every step's a chore. I just shouldn't have fallen asleep. Earlier, I mean. Technically, by virtue of riding shotgun, all navigation today had been my job, so although I hadn't done the actual driving, I felt partially responsible for our predicament. To make matters worse, I couldn't even work out our current location because my phone still wasn't picking up any signal. When I started digging in the boot, it was mainly to give my hands something tangible to do. Idle hands to the devil's work, as the old saying goes. But it wasn't as straightforward as all that. Last week, Tony had broken the little light that comes on when you open the lid of the boot, so I had to rummage in darkness. I was looking for my head torch. Last spring I'd been on a sport climbing course and I'd brought the strap-on gadget along on our trip. It had to be somewhere in the... That's when my fingers touched the gun. A gun? Must be Tony's. Drew can be a nutcase, but even he's not mad enough to bring a firearm on a plane into a foreign country, and it certainly wasn't mine. Was the gun loaded? Course it was. Why else bring it? I didn't bother to yell. I could see my friends above halfway down the road by the light of their mobiles, which they were using as flashlights. Right then, the thing moved. My eyes had adjusted to the darkness, and the Milky Way did the rest. The dark bundle shifted. It wasn't dead. Not completely. Drew and Tony noticed something, too. They stopped in their tracks and crouched defensively. Guys, can you tell what it is? I don't think they heard me. My voice was halfway stuck in my throat. By then, the movement had ceased and Drew and Tony continued. I wasn't sure what to do next. At last, I had an idea, and as such, it was so ingenious, it almost cost me my life. Nobody had looked at the front of the car. In the center of the bumper, there was a winch with a big, sturdy rope. The hook at the end of the rope was tied to the left edge of the bumper. I'd find some trace of the animal, some fur to tell me whether it'd be safe to approach. What if Tony was right? If it was someone rather than an animal, what then? I remembered the Indian I'd seen before, a Yaguita or Guarani or whatever tribe the locals up here belong to. I pictured the face clearer now, with more detail. Weather-beaten it was, with deep, leathery furrows, eyes downcast and shielded by an oversized straw hat. You know what I mean. Bloodshot, piercing eyes, harmless in daylight, but scary as hell at the side of a road in the middle of the night. What if we'd trodden on sacred ground or something? Who knows how many inscrutable laws we might have unwittingly violated just by being here. I mean, maybe we should have stopped at one of the Cauchito Hill roadside altars that dotted the landscape. We could have easily left a handful of pesos or a few cigarettes or a bottle of beer. What if Drew navigated onto one of their graveyards, desecrating it sideways, and then some... Now their spirits had caught up with us. I wiped my hand over my eyes to chase away the harrowing thoughts. Focus. Focus. I need to focus. At last I found my head torch and I almost clicked it on with the beam pointing at me. It would have been a huge mistake. The bright light would have flooded my dilated pupils and I'd have been practically blinded. That'd be a right time for the torch, but this wasn't it, so I slipped the straps over my head where they were designed to go. Drew and Tony had nearly arrived. I wanted to say, wait, let me look at the bumpers first, but it was pointless. All I could do was hurry, which I did, and I almost stepped into the immense void that opened up before the heavy SUV. We'd been ever so lucky. The front wheels rested right on the edge of a huge drop. Another yard and we'd have plunged into the sheer emptiness below. I know it's practically bottomless because I did switch on the head torch and looked over the edge very carefully, afraid the loose topsoil under my feet would give. Besides a ledge about 5 meters down, there were no features, just a big void full of empty. Totally spooked, I turned towards my friends. Guys, I... The musky smell was back and simultaneously I heard snarling. The former wafted over from where Drew and Tony had presumably reached the roadkill, and the latter was neither human nor animal. It wasn't anything from this world. It was the scariest fucking sound I've ever heard in my life. Drew! Tony, I'm coming! I said and started in their direction. As I said, at this altitude, it's impossible to move very fast for any amount of time. The body needs more oxygen than the air supplies. I knew this, but I ran anyway, and predictably, I didn't get very far. My lungs forced me to stop, screaming for air. I turned my torch on and moved my head, but the beam didn't reach far enough. For an instant, I saw a brief flash, a reflection, like when a headlight hits the back of a cat's eye. I blinked and it was gone. When I clicked off the head torch, I saw nothing at all. Dread filled me while I listened. There was a growling, gnashing, rumbling, and it got worse. Footfall in the gravel. Before I knew it, I had pulled the gun and was wilding it blindly in search for a target. Drew! Tony, I'm here! Get down! Something or someone was coming at me. It might have been my friends, I might have been their best hope, but it might have been the thing. All I could do was wait, breathe, and hope my pupils would dilate in a hurry. So I waited. It was the longest 6 seconds of my life. Gradually, I made a movement ahead of me, coming closer. Dark spots at first, my breathing normalized, and I was tempted to call out again. I didn't, though. It would have been reckless. I needed every ounce of oxygen, even the lifting my arm, the pointing of the gun took its toll. The image that presented itself to me gradually was bad. Unspeakably bad. Drew was on the ground, was being devoured by two, no, three figures. I'm not kidding, and I'm not making this shit up. My best mate. I couldn't tell if the attackers were kneeling people or crouching animals. Tony was still alive, then running up the road. They were behind him too. He was stumbling out of breath and out of luck. They caught up fast. I wanted to shoot, but I couldn't get a clear shot. Not at that distance. My fingers caressed the trigger. An idea. I raised the barrel and fired in the air. I had to buy time, for Tony at least. My eyes stayed on him, and the report ripped through that night and echoed off somewhere in the distance while the flash from the nozzle illuminated the scene for a fraction of a second. That's how I knew it was too late for Tony, too. His pursuers lunged through the air and brought him down to the ground. The sound was excruciating. I knew there wasn't a thing I could do to help. It'd be me next. What to do? I couldn't drive away. Drew never leaves keys in the ignition. It's an old habit of his. I stuck the gun and the flashlight into my belt and made for the car. My subconscious had come up with a plan and my body obeyed without any conscious thought on my part. Next thing I knew, I'd grabbed the end of the rope from the winch in the bumper, tied it around my waist and was abseiling onto the ledge below the car I'd spotted earlier with astonishing dexterity. The sport climbing course last spring was money well spent. I just stepped over the fucking edge as though I did this every day, not a moment's hesitation. Meanwhile, the hellish beasts were catching up. I can't think of a better way to describe them. I never got a really good look at them, and I hope I never will. Since then, I've been on a ledge, my safe haven, writing this down for posterity, I guess, just in case. For now, I seem to be all right here. It's been an hour or so, and they're still up there, but at least they can't follow me down. I can hear them from time to time. Awful sounds. If they're feline or canine by nature, their paws can't hold onto a rope. I reckon if I can make it through the night, they'll go back to whatever hellhole they spend the daytime, and I can climb back up. I'll get the car keys, back up whatever's left of my two friends, God, and drive to safety. Fuck! I mean, what the fuck's just happened? It must be 1 o'clock or 1:30. That means I'll get light in 5 hours or so. I'll sit down now and try to get some rest. If I fall asleep, I mustn't roll over the edge. Anybody wake? Shit, that's Drew's voice and it's coming from somewhere up there where the beasts are. How can he? I saw him die, didn't I? I've got to stop writing to find out what's...
Police files. Province of Jujuy. 10th of October 2019. Classified. Redacted. Regarding the discovery of the lifeless body of the three white males, Kevin Alton Kreuzer, British national, date of birth 11th of March 1995, Andrew White, US national, date of birth 28th of February 1995, and Antonio Quartz de la Sierra, Argentine national, date of birth 1st of January 1994, of Ruta Nacional 40 on an unnumbered dirt track commencing at kilometer redacted by Officer Gonzalez, batch number redacted. All three deaths occurred at the presumed result of redacted and exposure following a road accident. Relatives have been informed that due to the injuries sustained and due to the ensuing fire, all corpses have been badly charred. The gun recovered from the scene has been deemed irrelevant to the cause of deaths. Due to recent unexplained occurrences on this section of road, suggest recommendation redacted until further notice.